Abhishek Singh, who has been a pioneer in e-governance initiatives with a rich experience in Nagaland, Uttar Pradesh, and also Additional Secretary in the Government of India. May I request Abhishek to start your presentation?
Thank you, sir, and I extend my gratitude to DIPG for convening this panel, and the deliberations at the National Conference since yesterday has been stellar, and we have been listening to the presentations from experts within India, from Singapore, and it's a good time to reflect on where we are in our journey of e-governance and what we can do to enable ease of living for ordinary citizens. Dr. Rajeshwar Rao sir mentioned about the path-breaking digital platforms of UPI, Aadhaar, and the upcoming Ayushman Bharat Digital Health Mission. So I would carry forward on the same lines without repeating much of what we already know, and try to see where we are with regard to in what ways we can leverage technology that is available today for enabling ease of living for citizens, reducing hardship for citizens, ensuring that citizens are able to interact with government in such a way that they have a pleasant experience of when they interact with any government office. That remains the motto of e-governance. It's not about technology, it's about citizen, keeping the citizen at the core and ensuring that all our technology, all our softwares, all our systems, all our hardware ultimately leads to the citizen having a comfort of life, as also interacting with the government as a single whole, rather than interacting with different government departments. So I just present a brief few slides and then we'll go on to a discussion wherein we can address more such issues. Next slide, please. Yeah, so when we look at the life cycle of a citizen, like when a citizen interacts with government at various forums, so right from his birth to his death, he requires various kind of certificates which are digital in nature, but then he has to go from one government portal to another government portal to apply for those certificates, and sometimes some of the certificates are required by one government, are issued by one government department. As the citizen, even if he is getting electronically, even if he is getting online, he is supposed to get the certificate from one source, then attest it, print it, then submit, scan it, and then submit to another government portal. So the question is that when we are looking at a digital way of living, and when all these certificates are digitized, can we think of having all these certificates right from the birth to the caste to education, Aadhaar, voter ID, PAN card, the health, the electronic health record, the will certificate or death certificates? Can all these things, all these certificates being issued by various government systems and databases talk to each other, and the citizen would not be required to act as a courier for submitting these certificates? So this requires a simple redesign of services, and today technology and especially things like APIs allows government systems to talk to each other. All that we require is having a common standards in doing that. So the DigiLocker initiative of the government, which has almost 9 crore plus subscribers today, more than 460 crore documents on it, is enabling that transition. How is it doing that? Next slide, please. The DigiLocker is joining the dots to the e-governance ecosystem. What is doing that? When we look at the various system documents which are issued through the DigiLocker, whether it's your Aadhaar card or PAN card or driving licenses or academic bank of credits through which you access your academic certificates, all are available in a digital format with the citizen. And they all are linked with your common DigiLocker ID, which is linked to the Aadhaar. So all these documents get linked to the common ID which a citizen has. So with that ID, these documents can be shared across ecosystems. So when a child is born and he becomes part of the ICDS system, and the Anganwadi worker creates a vaccination record or the nutrition record about his height and weight, that becomes the first record along with his birth certificate that becomes part of the DigiLocker. As the child grows up, when he goes to the school education system, his academic records comes in. When he goes higher education, his university college documents come in. When he gets a driving license, that document comes in. Voter ID comes in. The PAN card comes in. And all these documents are linked to the ID. So the DigiLocker ecosystem will provide verification of these documents through a API interface. It has already been done in the vaccination certificates, COVID vaccination certificates, which are standardized with the health ID that is there. And today, anyone wanting to verify your vaccination certificate can do that by accessing the records through APIs. It ensures complete privacy, it includes complete data security, but it results in a lot of ease of living for citizens. So today, if I want to verify the vaccination certificate of my Zomato delivery boy or the Amazon delivery agent, I am able to do that. APIs enable that. So this is this digital document ecosystem, the digital wallet of DigiLocker is enabling this integration across government departments. And today it's possible to not submit paper certificates for verifying your digital certificates. What are the various use cases that we have seen? What are the use cases like, for example, Cowin APIs? I've already mentioned how Cowin APIs are being used to verify the vaccination certificates. Another very important use case, very useful use case that we observed last year was when Delhi University was doing the university admission and the students were not able to come to the universities to submit their paper certificates or notarized or attested certificates because of the pandemic. The entire verification of class 12th marks happened through APIs and the APIs with the certificates which are already available on the DigiLocker. 100,000 citizens could get admissions without requiring to submit paper certificates, and that eliminated the requirement of offline data sharing. Similarly, Karnataka State Police was doing recruitment for their constables and they require verification of class 10th and 12th mark sheets. Again, the earlier system used to take more than 6 months because it required a physical verification of certificates. And there also, there used to be a lot of cases of forgery, a lot of cases of fake certificates being submitted. But again, with the DigiLocker interface, with API, this certification was enabled. And more than 10 lakh candidates, their certificates were verified. And the entire recruitment cycle came down by 6 months. Passport application, today when you apply for passports, you can give consent for fetching your date of birth data and address data from the DigiLocker. And that allows you to apply for a passport without submitting any paper certificate. That again, an ease of living for citizens. Ministry of External Affairs is using the e-Sanad system, wherein again, digital verification of certificates is done electronically without requiring to communicate with various boards through mail or through any other follow-up mechanism. Once the API-based verification is done, it's done electronically and does result in a lot of convenience for citizens. So what are the possibilities? So with this kind of ecosystem, and when more and more documents are coming to the DigiLocker ecosystem, we are able to ensure a database-to-database sharing of information across government departments. So do we require to now, can we think of a system in which very often for various government tenders, we require companies who are bidding for the projects to submit their incorporation year certificate, to submit their turnover certificate, to submit their income tax returns? All these documents are today available in a digital format. Why do we require paper certificates to be scanned and attested and uploaded on the system? We don't need that. We can do XML-based verification based on the consent of the person who is applying for that. So that will ensure quicker decision-making, that will ensure a lot of convenience for citizens, for companies, and ensure a real integrated open architecture, open interoperable systems that can build up. Then we are also working with Rural Development Department for bringing the MGNREGA job cards onto the DigiLocker ecosystem. What MGNREGA job card today does is that we spend almost 1,50,000 crores on MGNREGA wages. And most of these people, the poor people, bottom of the pyramid, they do say 100 days of wage employment, say for 300 rupees per day, and they get 30,000 rupees annually, which is a guaranteed income for them. But they don't have any evidence to show or any mechanism to verify that this is the income that they have. So if the once these DigiLock, the MGNREGA job cards, along with the ledger of their income, comes onto this digital interface, then it will be possible to verify this income electronically. And this will mean a lot for microfinance and giving them, I'm able to prove that I have a guaranteed income of 30,000 rupees, I can get a credit for 5,000 rupees. And that will ensure that a lot of financial credit is given, a lot of guaranteed loans are given, and that will lead to livelihoods and that will lead to economic growth in a big manner. Similarly, we have worked with State Bank of India for getting the bank statements and Form 16 on the DigiLocker. And this would again allow small businesses to prove that they have a cash flow and they have a viable business model, which can lead to better credit decisions. And this will ultimately plug in into the account aggregator ecosystem, which will ensure expansion of microfinance, which will ensure provision of more credit, and which will ensure economic growth. So there, the use of such simple technologies and based on the platforms that we have built in of Aadhaar, of UPI, of DigiLocker and the consent framework will ensure economic growth in a big manner. Another service that we are working on and hopefully we'll be able to do is that the address change service. Because one of the very hardships which everyone faces whenever they move cities or whenever they move jobs is to update their addresses in various documents, like the mobile phones or the electricity bill or the bank accounts and the credit card accounts. But most of these documents are linked to an Aadhaar. And if the address is updated on Aadhaar, can we build up a consent-based mechanism in which the citizen will say that, yes, I give my consent for updating my address on all these databases. And then based on the address that is updated on the Aadhaar ecosystem, all the addresses on the phone, on the credit card, on the bank account, on the water bill, electricity bill is all updated. So it can be a voluntary, it can be a consent-based system. And hopefully we'll be able to roll this out very soon. The other thing about which our secretary spoke yesterday was that's again something that's needed for reducing the hardship for citizens, for enabling ease of living, is national single sign-on. So right now, all these online services across portals, across state governments, across ministries, they require citizens to sign on through multiple IDs. Can we think of having a one-stop authentication system? Once I have proved my identity to one government system, that becomes the source of verification for accessing other services on other portals. That would require, of course, building the right security systems in order to ensure that there is no misuse, abuse of the system. But it will result in a lot of convenience for citizens, because most people today struggle to remember their credentials across government systems. And if I have this information, if I can prove myself with my, say, single sign-on, it can be a DigiLocker sign-on, or it can be a Parichay, it can be a Praman, any single sign-on that the government decides, then I will ensure that I'm able to prove that. To prevent misuse, multi-factor authentication can be there, but it will improve service delivery in a great manner, and it will also lead to proactive service delivery. And once we are able to do that, once the databases of, say, RD department, health department, and education department talk to each other, then once I know that somebody is a beneficiary for a rural development department, somebody is a MNREGA beneficiary, he might also be a beneficiary for Ayushman Bharat health insurance scheme. So once we have identified beneficiary by one department, I will be able to proactively offer services of other departments what the citizen is entitled to. So instead of a citizen requiring to apply to multiple departments for service delivery, he can just prove what he is, what his background is, what services he is eligible for, and then it will be the responsibility of the government, concerned government department, to offer him those services proactively. So this will be a paradigm shift in service delivery, but with the background that we have built in the public digital platforms and the open API-based architectures that we have, this is a distinct possibility today, and hopefully we'll be moving towards this for enabling ease of living. So these are the few thoughts that I wanted to share. There's a lot that we can talk about, but we have other panelists, and with the want of time, I will limit myself to only these few ideas that I wanted to share on this forum today.
Thank you, Abhishek, for unveiling the Vishwarupam of e-governance, which is omnipresent and everywhere. Abhishek has mentioned some of the major mega initiatives, but friends, you are aware that these initiatives are happening even at the municipal level, at the major gram panchayat level and district level, benefiting the citizens on improving their ease of living and also the ease of doing business. Thank you, Abhishek.